Henry Nestle looks out from his sepia Victorian photograph, his dark, slightly hooded eyes betraying an intensity and air of concentration. His thinning hair is neatly swept back from a broad forehead. The customary beard, a little unruly, the only hint of disorder. This imposing figure was known locally as a merchant, but he had real flair as a scientist and entrepreneur. Born in Frankfurt in 1814, Heinrich Nestle left Germany as a young man to travel, and like Peter, he chose to settle by the beautiful shores of Lake Geneva in Vevey. Changing his name to Henry Nestle, he rapidly demonstrated his versatility as an entrepreneur, a maverick, and scientist. Quite apart from his trade as a druggist, selling medicines, seeds, and mustards, his interest in oil lamps flourished into a business for the manufacture of liquid gas. His small company lit a dozen or so of the gas lamps in Vevey and also manufactured fertilizer. Henry Nestle was astonished by the developments in the food manufacture, and by 1847 he had begun to research infant feeding. This was an era still plagued by infant mortality. In Switzerland, 1 in 5 babies died before their first birthday. The challenge for Henry Nestle was to create a new type of food for babies whose mothers were unable to breastfeed. Since milk turned rancid so quickly, the puzzle was how to keep milk fresh. Using his own kitchen as a laboratory, Nestle experimented with different ways of preserving whole milk. By 1866, he had a solution. He found a way to create a milk powder concentrated by an air pump at low temperature that he believed was as fresh and wholesome as Swiss milk straight from the cow's udder. To this, he added a cereal baked by a special process of my invention to create a unique formula he called Ferrine Lactee. By chance, in September 1867, Henry Nestle was approached by a friend who was treating a premature baby boy. The baby was convulsive and could not breastfeed or keep down any alternative. His mother was very ill as well. After 15 days, the baby's survival hung in the balance. But to the family's delight, they discovered that he was able to digest Nestle's formula. News of this miracle spread across town. It was an anxious moment when Daniel and Fanny Peter tried to coax baby Rose to drink Henry Nestle's formula. The baby was fretful, hungry, but unable to keep food down. After a few moments came the sounds the distraught parents had so longed to hear. The normal suckling from a contented baby. The milk lived up to its promise. Rose recovered and began to put on weight. Doctors tested the product and reached the same result. Mothers began to ask for it. Described skeptics who insisted it was no more than a sack of flour. Nestle was full of confidence in his new invention. "My discovery has tremendous value," he declared, "for there is not another food comparable to my baby food." In 1868, after successful launches in Vevey and Lucerne in Switzerland and his hometown of Frankfurt, demand continued to rise. Certain of success, he dispatched a sales team in France and ventured to England to open an office in London. Believe me, it's no small matter to market an invention in 4 countries simultaneously, he said. He installed a large new vacuum pump and was able to manufacture more than half a ton of dried infant milk a day. Even with the outbreak of the Franco-Prussian War in July 1870, which made it harder to move goods around Europe, the company's growth seemed unstoppable. By 1871, around 1,000 yellow cans rolled off his production line each day. 3 years later, the numbers had risen to 500,000 of cans of infant cereal a year that were being sold on 5 continents. With all the problems of manufacture, distribution, shipping, and sales, managing the firm was becoming too demanding for Nestlé, who was approaching 60. In 1875, he sold his company for 1 million Swiss francs to a Swiss businessman who brought everything, including the rights to Nestlé's name. One of the witnesses to the sale was Henry's friend and neighbor, Daniel Peter. He settled with his family in Montreux and Glion, where they helped people with small loans and publicly contributed towards improving the local infrastructure. In Glion, he moved into a house later known as Villa Nestlé. His life, even after his work life, proved to be productive and helpful to millions of people. Nestlé ultimately died of a heart attack in Glion on 7 July 1890 and was buried at Thuriot Cemetery in Montreux.
यही रास्ता है तेरा तूने अब जाना है हाँ यही सपना है तेरा तूने पहचाना है रास्ता है तेरा तूने अब जाना है